night. Hey, Dylan. Come on, you.
You are listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast.
Write it in your little book. Is just start
in your dream journal.
After whatever the opening song, whatever the closing song is, people know they can hang around for the outtakes. That way, you don't have to worry about how to edit it. People will know if they listen long enough, they'll hear the outtakes of when we thought we should add a little to the podcast that we finished.
Let me get this straight. We ramp right into this.
Did you write it down?
No, I'm fleshing it out and I'm going to write it down.
Just any bullshit that we go, that'll fucking never go out.
After the closing song?
Yeah. And then people, if they're fucking hip enough, will know.
It's like a hidden track
listening.
On a CD.
Exactly. Every podcast drifts into fucking outtakes.
So this will go at the beginning of the next podcast. So they know
you're overthinking.
Here's the problem. Here's the problem. When you look at it, it says an hour and 52 minutes.
And, so you already know.
But so you'd have to put in the clip on, okay, it's an hour and 10 minutes. And then,
Do you even know how podcasts
work?
No.
Okay. I know when people said, hey, I saw that podcast, it's 2.5 hours. And I was like, fuck that. And I'm glad I listened to it. But I don't want them to think like this is already way too long. I want them to know that, okay, it's going to go up till the closing song. And then there'll be a bunch of bullshit you can listen to afterwards that we either cut out or doesn't make sense. Or it's funny because we thought it was funny because we're drunk.
And that will be at the front of the
first
podcast.
But that's not a hidden track if they see that it's an hour and 52 minutes and only an hour and 10 is what we really planned on.
People are smarter than us. When they hit play on their podcast, the Doug Stanhope podcast, and then they'll see the runtime. Okay? They're going to know.
That's what I'm talking
about. Yes.
Pass me the lampshade, I'm drunk again. Blew my drug money on a quart of gin. Well, I am a cultured man with tastes discriminating, but I'll settle for a tall glass of anything. With love and death and darkness. If I'm a bad drunk, well, it's not for lack of practice. There is no, this is no modern romance. 'Cause I'm going home in a fucking ambulance. Well, am I the only one drinking tonight?
Doug Stanhope podcast back taped in the U.S. I was fucking terrified that Hennigan would have podcasting equipment with him when we went to St. Martin. He did have a lot of shit. He might have. He probably did, and he just didn't break it out. He did make me work one night. And then, we have to 3 hours a day. We should spend doing this, this, and this. And one day we did 3 hours of shit.
Like what?
This is like taking notes on projects and shit. Stuff. We should map out the rest of the year. Well, we didn't. You know what? We didn't.
Wait a minute. You did. I'm retired. That maps it out.
Yeah, I know. But in order for me to enjoy retirement, I have to know that he is clawing at every possible angle to do something else. But he had an epiphany. He told me he had an epiphany. He called me when we split ways at the Atlanta airport. But I don't want to tell you now. And well, you've been drinking on the fucking plane, so I know how your drinking epiphanies go. I have never ever written anything on a plane that went anywhere. Like, even into, I mean, maybe a couple things. I shouldn't say anything, but all I ever remember are notes that make no fucking sense. And as I spend a lot of time on planes jotting shit down, because you have all the time in the world to sit there and cocktail and have no one to talk to or interrupt you.
I was going to say the same thing about being in a car and driving to a gig. You're like an 8-hour drive to a show.
I've had
fantastic
ideas. And
I'll smoke 100 hitters and I'll be like, this joke about Darth Vader is going to get me on the Tonight Show. And then you tell it and they stare at you and you're like, "What? I'm with you, audience. I don't know what the fuck that was or why I thought it was funny."
I can only work out. I had a bit that I finally got working towards the end of this tour that I wrote on one of those nightmare mile grab trips where I flew from here to Orlando to Anchorage and then decided to, I'll go to open mic. I'm here for 6 hours. I ended up staying an extra day, but I went to open mic with all these notes I wrote on the airplane and fucking nothing. But then a couple of them I did get to work, but just doing open mic, if I don't have my own audience now, where I can, you know, fucking riff for 10 minutes about bullshit. Yeah. If I have, you know, a 10-minute slot and I know there's 8 comics going, fuck, he's taking my time, man.
Yeah.
Look at Stanhope up there with notes.
So could Doug Stanhope start in comedy again?
No. Absolutely not.
So
what we did when we started in Canada last year. Not really. Not even like starting from scratch with nothing I've ever said before. It almost sounds fun. It sounds like there'd be no
pressure. When you're sitting here, it sounds fun. Like, this is going to be a fun idea. Well, and then you get there. And you're like,
you did talk about that because what happened was your special was going to come out while we were in Canada. Like four nights into the run across Canada, east to west. And that was the night. It was like, this is it. This is the last, we were in London. And that was the last night you were able
to do. London, Ontario.
That was the last night you were going to be able to do those jokes because it came out either
specials,
the night before or that night.
It was coming
night.
Out like, that night. I know you're not seeing it now because you're here.
You were like, what time zone are we in? Where is it going to? It was like so specific. You're very particular in that way. And then after that, it was fucking go back to notes, listen to shows.
But it wasn't. I mean, some of that shit is stuff that never got recorded on an album. Yeah. There's still almost 25 years, you have fallback material.
Didn't you do that in Australia too a little bit?
To because I had to cut out my entire closer over here. Just none of it. I tried the first night to dice that up so it made sense in Australia. But it's, you know, that's a 20 fucking minute bit that goes, weaves in and out of stuff. And, you know, okay, the way I do it, every other U-turn goes into a fucking brick wall and there's no way to make a straight road out of this without just rewriting the bit. So fuck it, I'll just write. I mean, I was doing too much time anyway. I always do.
That's your every night. Chaille, tell me like at 55, send me a shot. Have Bingo bring it up. And it's like at 1 hour, 25 minutes. I'm like, wow.
Yeah, good thing he got that shot to him.
He still hasn't drank the shot.
Yeah. Bring me a shot at 55 minutes and make me drink it.
That's when we have the shot glasses.
So Hennigan had an epiphany on the plane. That's probably right about the time he texted me asking me to go to Mexico and get him some Zoloft. So it might be great.
What's Zoloft?
I don't know.
It's not for him. It's for a friend.
Really?
All right. But what is Zoloft?
That's a depression.
Antidepressant.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's something.
Oh, no. My mom's on that. She's 80.
Yeah.
This is not the way you wanted to find out what Zoloft was.
Yeah. Every girl is on it. And he knows a girl that can't afford full price.
Well, we just got back from...
That's why he sent me the text, because he'd heard we'd crossed over.
Yeah, but it was surprisingly crossed over. It was surprisingly easy to get the pills that we went over there for.
Yeah, you can say it.
Well,
it's Xanax.
Xanax.
That's all they have that you would use yeah, recreationally want, right. Is Viagra or Xanax and occasionally Ritalin. There's no like opiates. There's no painkillers.
Oh, I didn't even think. What was that thing we did on Super Bowl? Adderall. I didn't even think. Do they have Adderall in Mexico?
No, they have. Well, not when they used to. When we used
Adderallo. I'm sorry, Adderallo.
No, it was Ritalin, which is kind of the same thing, I guess.
Is it?
Remember, I don't know if you were here for that. Yeah, one of the initial Super Bowl parties.
I saw that mess.
Yeah. Fucking Hack Oddity was here, and there'd just be right there at those chairs. It'd just be a pile of people just chopping up Ritalin and snorting it. I remember when we did that as a joke in the desert party, and then all of a sudden, wait, that works? I did not partake.
Yeah. That was a messy.
I mean, I have.
It was a messy day. Well, the desert's a different thing. You're in an experimental mode.
Every fucking episode, we go back to the desert party. I remember a Sopranos episode where he comes in and at the fucking man cave. They probably didn't call it a man cave. The clubhouse.
Yeah.
The
and they're
cherry.
All talking old stories, and Tony Soprano comes all pissed off. And he goes, something to the effect of quit telling old stories because it just means you're not doing anything recently. That's all I think about every time the fucking old desert party stories come up. I just got back from Maho Beach in the St. Martin in the Dutch Antilles.
I was waiting for that.
Which we extended our trip by a couple days for all we did is sit at a fucking beach bars and drink. Me and Hennigan jumped in the water once when we were very drunk. And then at the end of the vacation, aren't you glad we jumped in the water once just so we can say we did? Because that was it. At one point, I did jump in the pool at the last hotel in a little pink children's inflatable pool ring that I almost got stuck in.
They didn't have a proper pool,
they had a pool, but they didn't. I didn't want it. It was kind of cold, so I wanted to sit there and drink a drink, which I give you these little 8 ounce, not even solo cups, but the plastic shit we make mimosas here. It's a fucking 8 ounce vodka. You're gonna be in the pool for about 4 minutes, and then I need another drink.
That's
fuck
the Dutch
this.
Dude. When we were in Amsterdam, Erickson was with us when we were in Amsterdam, not to tell an old story, but all of the glasses of beer were 8 ounces or less. They were small cups of beer. I think that's a European thing where they don't need a big gulp and a monster truck.
To be fair, whatever it is, 8 ounces, 10 ounces, it's the same as a rocks glass.
Yes, or a highball, they call it.
But first of all, I fucking hate drinking out of plastic.
Uh-huh.
And when you're at the pool, you're getting plastic.
Yeah.
Unless you get a beer, and then you can't have it in the fucking pool. You sit there at the bar in the shade. How tan do I look? Not very. I was just as tan from sitting outside.
You probably got that on the ride back from Tucson if you were on the right side of the car. Well, you know, I got a fix for you. If you don't want a plastic cup, try to order a Moscow Mule because it comes in a copper mug.
I was so fucking embarrassed. First of all, we stayed at three different places. The first 3 days, we stayed at kind of a dump, which was obviously the best one of the three. Then Super Bowl comes, and we panic. We don't have a plan because we figure after 3 days, we'll find a cool bar that's showing it, and everyone we ask, you got to go to one of the casinos, like one of the resorts. So we
to
just
even
picked
see it,
one,
or just
well,
because
to
you
make
just wanna...
sure the sports bars that were on that boardwalk in Phillipsburg that we were at, some cool bars, but even the one that said sports bar, like, oh, do you have Super Bowl? No, they're closed Sunday. A lot of shit was closed Sunday. So we bought off Expedia some fucking all inclusive, too expensive, and it was just. It was a cruise ship.
Like a
sandals?
It was
a fucking landlocked cruise ship of elderly fucking people and a buffet and just awful. It's 3 hours to check in and just tour buses full of people dropping off literally truckloads of luggage in this monstrous lobby. And then by the time Super Bowl comes, they have a 10-foot inflatable screen out by the pool with stacking pool chairs and maybe 40 people, average age about 65. And, you know, couples, women that don't want to watch the Super Bowl. No one's into the game.
Right.
And we're sitting there and it's kind of cold. It's windy as shit. I don't like wind, if you don't know that. I also don't like balloons. We'll get to that.
Because they're filled with wind.
Yes.
It's obvious.
Exactly. Volatile wind.
We had more people here at your house in Bisbee, the compound, than they had at the Sandal-esque resort.
Yeah, yeah. It was called the, I fucking have the thing. It's the Sinesta.
The drinking wristband.
I still have my armband. Oh, and by the way, if Rob, some guy that knew who I was, yeah, we met this guy, and he's like, oh, I'm at the Sinesta. And I go, we're probably going to go there tomorrow for the Super Bowl. He was a New England guy, and we were going to cheat and just say it was me and Bingo, and it would have been way less. But Brian's like, you need a wristband. And I went over, I go, I bet you have wristbands, right? And she goes, yeah, that's how they know you're good. And she goes, I can take mine off because my name's, and I'll just say it fell off and I'll get a new one and you can give yours. You know, Bingo can take that. And then we'll just say there's two people in the room because it's all inclusive, booze and food.
Per, right. per person.
Sure. It,
yeah.
It's a lot more.
Like a cruise ship.
It goes up
exactly.
Exponentially. So the, but there's two fucking Sinestas. So we went to the wrong one. We went to one. We get in a cab and they're like, which one? And he reads them the address. It's like four blocks down from where we were. We're supposed to be over at Maho Beach again. So we ended up watching the second half of the game in the room, just me and Hennigan and Bingo. But we had fun.
It was a good game.
Shit. It was a fantastic game.
Actually, that was a great game to be in a room to actually watch the game and not have people in front of you and or whatever.
It's the most Super Bowl I've watched in 5-6 years since we've built this fucking place. No hosting. It was great to just sit in bed and and goof on the commercials. The fucking Clydesdale commercial actually made me well up with fucking
tears my
God. And get goosebumps. That was in the first half, and I turned to the only couple that seemed to have any enthusiasm behind us, and I went, all right, that one made me well up a little bit. And then fucking screaming buzzkill like, at the screen during the Dead Kid commercial.
Oh, my God.
And, but no one's like, you're not getting any response. You're right. Like, you're just yelling, buzzkill, Dead Kid. And then no one even turns around.
It's like starting comedy over again.
Exactly what it was like. It was a fucking...
It's brutal out there.
Terrible place.
Doug welling up at a commercial, I just think of the Grinch. When the
when his heart grows, his heart grew three sizes that day.
So yeah, I have copious notes on all these places we stayed, the good, the bad, and the ugly that I'll save for Yelp reviews because it's the only fucking writing that I'm inspired to do.
So I was going to ask you about that because you have been doing Yelp reviews. In the
I haven't
past
done any
months.
In a while, but
you've done some in the past. Some have been pulled down. And
there's one I'm putting back up, that fucking first one about that cantina. Anyway,
but how would, if someone wanted to follow your Yelp reviews, can you go in? Cause I don't know how this works. Do they go into your profile and then they can see all the things that you?
Yes, I believe so. I don't know because all I do is write them and then I put them out on. Brian figures out how to put them on Facebook so they go to Twitter. I just
probably,
write them and
it's
then
probably
Brian...
a link. Tracy, there's a computer over there. Go, can you just get it so we can get the, I'll cut this out. Just get the link.
Don't even, don't, you know what? Don't even tell her to do that or cut it out. Cause I have at least five or six that I have to write. So I want to write those before we start telling people, go check it out. Cause I got to write the fucking things in the next couple of days because if I'm going to quit smoking, I got to get all the writing out of the way now. I'm going to be sitting in here. We've moved the podcast over to the fun house because football's over. I can sit in here. I can smoke the shit out of this place. We can podcast. I can write. Read some books.
You read?
Yeah, that's the whole fucking point of going, leaving the country to go on vacation. And then all of a sudden I feel like a dick for... A, sitting in bed till 2 o'clock in the afternoon reading, going, there's a beach out there. And Bingo's going, Stanhope, Stanhope. You want to come out? Stanhope, come to the bar, Stanhope. And then I go, I kind of want to read, but I can't read. I brought one book that I was really into that I knew would motivate me. Mm-hmm. And then I brought shit I can read when I'm drunk, because if I miss something, I don't care. And I was actually, the guy's kind of cool. He sent me some shit. I don't know how to pronounce his last name, but it's Gene Gregoritz or Gregoritz. He sent me a bunch of shit a while ago. He's a Bukowski-esque. He's one of those just, I'm a fuck up. His books are all just, I'm a fuck up, and then I was broke in a snowbank, and I pissed my pants, and I'm a fuck. It's just that, but, you know.
That's enough.
That's enough. And I don't, like, if I fell asleep reading it, I don't go, oh, I missed some stuff. I better go back a chapter.
Yeah.
So I know where I'm at.
That's Whenever anybody talks about reading, I always think of my, we talked about this guy a couple of nights ago, and J. Scott Holman.
Oh, yeah.
Has one of my absolute favorite jokes. And this was years ago when the movie was coming out, and he said, oh, that new Cat in the Hat movie. I can't do a J. Scott Holman. Hey, that new Cat in the Hat movie is coming out. Someone said, hey, you see that new Cat in the Hat movie? I said, no, I read the book. I've always wanted to say that. And I fucking laughed so goddamn hard at that.
That was a pretty good Jay Scott. I always drift into Ron White when I do Jay Scott, but yeah.
Jay Scott, I booked him up at Coots on your recommendation, and that's when they didn't flame out. So I forgot to give you note. That's a win.
I didn't mean to steer this discussion away from what we were talking about.
No,
I fucking love that guy and that joke. Every time anyone mentions reading a book, my mind automatically goes to that joke right away.
Yeah.
There's two I read. There's one I read in Australia by this guy, and Dog Days Part One. And it's his life in, Philly or Baltimore. And then. And then it says in Costa Rica at one point, and I'm like, oh, I'm all about Costa Rica. And then I get to the end of the book, and he goes, see part two for the Costa Rica part. And I'm like, fuck.
Fuck me.
What was it called?
Dog Days, part one and two. Gene.
No, I'll get that. But
Gregoritis.
Gregoritis.
You said Gregoritz before.
Yeah, that's how it's spelled. Gregor.
ITS.
So, yeah. So this time I get to read part two with Costa Rica. And I did. He doesn't tweet much, but I did tweet him. Hey, aside from the bullshit, there's no fucking Presidente beer in fucking Costa Rica. It's Imperial and Pilsen. I didn't even call him on that. But, yeah, it's some factual. Yeah, it's a diary, and then at one point he's fighting with his girlfriend and shit. Stuff I could relate to from Costa Rica, you know, me and Renee. So we had some. So yeah, there's a lot of the. Hey, I can relate to this. It's very relatable. And then one entry was February 29th, 2009, at the whatever bar in Hako, and I go, hang on a second. There was no February 29th in 2009 because leap year falls on presidential election. It would have been 08, 012, but you fucked up.
And it's like, maybe we have a million little pieces situation.
Doug's fact-checking while he's recreationally reading during retirement.
I think we went over this last podcast or one of them. Where we're like, I have a strong bullshit to tell.
Oh, that was the one. That was the podcast that will never air. Funyun.
Funyun
Olio.
Butters. Yeah, we can. Well, it doesn't matter.
We're not going to put it out.
Yeah, it's not going out.
That'll make it the most popular Doug Stanhope podcast of all time. Every series of shows or whatever it is.
Some friend of ours had a friend. He brought a friend over, and I called. I spotted some bullshit in the friend right away and said, hey, you want a podcast? And then just undressed every part of his story. Like, you just made up all these fantastic lies. And he was a young kid, and then he ended up crying. So we're not going to put that up.
This is the amazing thing about Doug is that You can, at the compound, you can do whatever you, it's so open. Everyone understands it's fucking, it's fun to hang out here. But the minute you start lying, it's like someone puts
putting
the,
on airs. You
someone,
can't do that.
Yeah. Someone
is not even, you can even be a poser, but you just start throwing out bullshit lies and trying to self-aggrandize on such a phony level.
It's like someone dropped one of those morning breeze capsules, that sulfur. And then the,
everyone's like
Doug's like, what the fuck? And he's like honed in on it. Let me check your shoe, brother. I think you just stepped on glass.
I think there's even people that probably come over that you embrace their full of shittedness. I won't mention names.
Careful.
But yeah, no, none of the regulars. But
you tolerate. Because you go, it's fun.
They're harmless. Yeah. I can name comics. So we all know. Wait, you have no notebook after two decades? You just, all this is off the top of your head? But you give them a pass because they're harmless. But yeah, when I don't know you and you just walk in and you start trying to. Anyway, my point was what? I still enjoyed the book. So I tweeted at him and I said, hey, aside from these factual.
Oh, you hit him up.
Oh, Gene, yeah.
Okay.
I've talked to him on Facebook once. The only time I ever go on Facebook, it's not my personal page, it's my regular page. And he had sent me these books, I guess he sent them afterwards, but somewhere I was stuck drunk in the middle of the night and had a decent conversation with him. Oh, he lives in St. Pete now.
And, Florida.
Yeah.
And where the Thunderbird
is. After whatever he sent me, I searched his name and it came up in a Google News search of he had been busted for sexually assaulting a minor. Which is kind of a theme to a lot of his books. He's like, you got to understand, this is complete bullshit. Like, I fucking know. And I have that St. Pete story with you where I could have been in the same fucking boat exposing myself to minors, which I know I've told that story. But I was giving myself fucking wedgies on the beach with my jock strap under my my swimsuit. So I'm yanking my jock strap to right up underneath my nipples, like giving front wedgies to myself and bloating my gut out as far as I could bloat it for funny pictures. And someone was just not amused by our drunkenness that lasted all day at the Thunderbird there in St. Pete and said I was exposing myself to kids. And if it weren't for Chaille having been taking a million pictures of it, I'd be in the same fucking.
No, she called the cops.
Yeah.
Cops showed up. And the only thing that got us off the hook was I had a camera that I would not let the cop touch, but I would go through the pictures going back knowing that there is a hand grenade going back because the night before
a comic friend of ours, we probably already outed him when we told
like a plate full of blood.
He has a midstream pee into the travel lodge.
Into his
mattress.
Own hotel bed, standing up, pissing his own bed. Whee!
Yay, I'm a champion.
Get this, Chaille.
Check
whoa,
it out.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
So Brendan Walsh was there.
No, it was a comic friend of ours.
Oh, a comic friend of yours. Yes. Oh, I get it.
Let's just say he didn't have a beard at the time.
Let's just say don't stay in room 103 at the Travel Lodge in Orlando.
Yeah.
Or in Orlando.
So anyway, the point is, I read that guy. And the last book I read, just because it was really quick, I read it in a fucking, I left it in the hotel. I got up at breakfast and read it by the time we checked out. It was that quick. And because it was interviews he did, it's called Portland 8 Mile. And it was just interviews he transcribed where he just showed up in Portland, broke, and he's a fucking scumbag. You know, he's a James Inman of writing, and it goes backwards. So it starts out with him getting back to Philly in the DTs, begging a cab driver to take him anywhere because he's freezing as the DTs and in a snowbank, and then goes backwards. But it was back to Portland. Dante's green room basement, and I'm like, oh fuck! And then he's talking to Jim Goad, and I'm like, oh fuck!
Yeah,
I've done mushrooms with Jim Goad in that basement, And then Callahan, you know the cartoonist Callahan? He's dead now.
No, yeah, he was like syndicated.
Didn't he write dark shit? I have the book up there on the shelf.
Was he disabled?
Yeah.
And he wrote with his mouth, didn't he? He was fucked up.
We're spreading such fucking urban legends now. He wrote with his mouth.
Bruce Jenner's now, they're married. Him and Bruce. No.
But he, he was a fan. I remember one time I played there. He emailed me or whatever. MySpace, who knows what the medium was at the time, and said he couldn't come to the show because he's disabled. But he sent a guy with an inscribed book for me of his cartoons, like really dark shit. He was fucking great. He interviewed him in the thing, and Callahan's talking about, oh, yeah, I was on the David Tell's Comedy Central show. And I'm like, I was on that same show in Portland. So it was wicked cool.
His name is John Callahan.
Yeah.
Well, I'm reading it. He died in 2010.
So, yeah, so those were fun reads. And then one book called Pranksters, Mirth Making in the Modern World.
Like a dissertation on pranks?
Pranks all the way from the original writers of the Illuminati bullshit. the New World Order.
Starting with the guys who wrote the Bible Rose and working Crucians. Their way on up.
Yes. Didn't go back far enough. Up through the Merry Pranksters and the Yes Men. And
yeah.
So that, right, yeah, that was inspiring. And but yeah, it felt like a dick for I take vacations in my head like I should be like how the story is going to tell when I get back here. And there's no story. Like, hey, you know, everyone's coming over to the house. So what was it like? It was like me sitting at a fucking bar and talking to a bartender. You find one cool bartender. We found a couple. And
smoking in bars.
Smoking everywhere.
You love that.
Because everything's outside. But even inside, I remember smoking.
That's kind of your heaven. Drinking and smoking, and then the bartenders drinking and smoking at the same time.
Oh yeah,
yeah. That's the 70s, right?
Yeah, fucking lot of people getting drug out of bars, like one on a stretcher at 4:30 in the afternoon.
I believe that's called carried or wheeled.
For the first 2 hours, they're just fanning him and shaking him and patting his head with water, trying. So after 2 hours, they finally just fuck this. The bartender's like, his friend paid his tab, and I said I'll pay for his taxi, but they couldn't get him like to open his eyes. And at some point, they called.
So it wasn't
ambulance.
A fight. It was someone passed out from exhaustion, or they just had a heart attack.
And drunk. You know, I thought it was going to be a lot prettier, like prettier people and stuff. It was. There was no beach. I was ashamed to walk around with no shirt on. That's hard to find
with your pulled up jock strap and your purposely bloated belly.
Yeah. Which is now always bloated like that.
I was approached by two models.
That's because your mom says you keep making that face. It's going to stick like that. Exactly. You've been doing that gut thing forever.
That's what happened with my entire fucking attitude of bitterness. This used to seem like it was a funny persona on stage, stuck like that.
It's called commitment to a bit, and you should be proud of yourself for it.
Yeah. Yeah, so we stayed at that low-rent joint, and then that one Sinesta. Oh, you'll get yelped, my friends. And then we found one that was Maho Beach. Was the reason I went, if I did not explain this already, Maho Beach. At one morning I woke up and I Google searched beach closest to an airport because I just wanted to get the fuck out of here because it's miserable and I had time off. And Maho Beach comes up, and the beach is literally 20 yards from the end of the runway. So you just stand there and planes, you're ducking, thinking this is a 747. This is a 340 Airbus that's crashing into me, and it comes right over your head. And that's amusing for three or four times. But then it's just all these fat, tubby fucking tourists sitting there. I'm even filming. I'm like, this is the ironic way I don't want to die is filming something rather than enjoying it.
Right.
Like all the shit I give my fans, just put your fucking camera away and enjoy it. I have film of Brian Hennigan filming it and then filming me and me filming. It's stupid. That and everyone else is doing it. And I know I'm an asshole.
That would be a great way, actually. I mean, it's an ironic way to die, but it would be great to see the plane just get closer and closer and closer to the camera until it hits you. It's like, I think that's really good. Yep. It's really gonna.
The scene in Airplane where it just keeps
you're coming. Floating yeah. above your fucking corpse going, Did I get it? Did I get the shot?
How come my cell phone's not working?
So, yeah, then we were there for 3 days going, all right, the plane thing I'm done with. Let's just sit by the pool in this fucking resort, not high dollar or all inclusive. Didn't even include an elevator that's been broken for 2 years.
2 years.
Yeah. Third floor. Oh, shit. I forget my cigarettes. Walk all the way back to the front of the hotel. Walk up the stairs. Walk to your room. Coffee makers. No coffee. You know, coffee makers that take a specific little package that are not available in the hotel or are at any stores. Yet they still have a... I asked. I go, you know what? For a hotel... You know how cunty I get. I get toned down if it's not a U.S. property because all of a sudden the customer is always right thing is gone.
Right.
Like, fuck you, whatever. We got your money. So I called down immediately. I go, I'm guessing because you're a five-story hotel with no elevator that you probably don't have an ice machine, but I figured I'd ask anyway. And they said, oh, yeah, we have an ice machine. It's in the first floor right past the lobby. And I go... Well, this where's the ice buckets? Because I don't have an ice bucket in my room. They go, oh, we don't have ice buckets. People usually use bags.
Ugh.
I mean, do you provide these bags?
Ice bags?
Ice bags. He goes, okay, sir, but wait, I'll try to find you an ice bucket. I go, don't worry, we'll come down and get it. So I sent Bingo down, and they say, oh, don't worry. They're bringing it up to your room. Just they're on their way. So she comes back up and says they're bringing it up. And 15 minutes later, knock on the door, and the guy gives me an ice bucket with no ice.
I think you have to respect that, frankly.
Yeah, but it did have a cool bar. That is, I guess the place used to be a timeshare, and now they've made it into a hotel property. And the elevator they have is supposed to be an indoor elevator, but it's outdoors, so the guy can never fix it. And they just keep having it. But they were cool Dutch people, a couple. Lori and Marty, thank you very much for making those 3 days wonderful. And that's what I was talking about. Bingo is so fucking embarrassing. And I understand to an extent, because when you do that much drinking, where you're just day drinking, that's going to lead to night drinking, and
in
everything's going to be closed at 8 o'clock. You have to change it up, but Bingo's making them do every fucking different kind of frozen drink. And what if I try? And it's there's never more than six people at the bar. So, which kind of makes it worse, because the bartender... He sits down on the other side of the bar, and he's chain-smoking and drinking and working on his computer. And he's Dutch, and he's just complaining about everything. He's a cool guy. He's one of us. He's fucking angry.
He's like you here.
He's like Hennigan, because he's smarter than everyone, and he's probably is, but he makes no bones about it, and it makes him bitter, these fucking people. He's telling you stories like you've known him forever. And they fucking, I go down and I go, what kind of a fucking, I can't do a Dutch accent, but what kind of a fucking building owner I can't give, you're the son-in-law and I can't pay you the rent. I'm supposed to come back at 5:30. Fuck you. Or you take the fucking money now. You fuck. I'll tell you, this is what you do. But he was fun. He occasionally smiled to let you know that he's fun. But Bingo, he just sit down. I don't want to be a bother, but can I try? What was the thing? Can you blend up Bailey's?
and I don't know, whiskey. What's it good? You know, like, I don't even want to sit next to you.
She's not with me.
Yeah. And I just drink Coors Light because...
To make it super easy.
I go,
yeah, as a counterbalance to her.
And I actually said that. I go, out of a sense of fair play, I'll make the next three Coors Lights to make up for my lady friend. But yeah, they were cool. And again, that's all you need. It's your bartender. Mm-hmm. Bartenders out there, fucking like Becker says, if I can get the same thing at home, you're not doing your job. And those guys did their job and made that fun. We'll take a piss and take a break, and I'll complain more about... But I will complain more about a high-dollar fucking vacation in 80-degree weather where I did not have a proper coffee maker.
No, you had the maker.
Yeah. Yeah, you had the maker. Yeah. No coffee.
If I had the proper coffee maker, I could have just bought coffee.
Ah, therein lies the rub.
Don't give me a Keurig machine when you have Mr. Coffee filters, assholes, because I'll rail about you. I'll take you down.
You're a Keurig man in a Mr. Coffee world.
All those fucking Doug Stanhope fans that were fucking racing towards the Dutch Antilles. Well, they're not going to stay at the fucking Sopapilla. What is it? The Sinesta. I have to look at my
Doug's
wrist.
Doug's looking at his wrist. As he does
that. Let's take a break. Hey, faggots, listen. We have merch. We have a donation button. And I don't like to ask you to do that. But we just got some fucking numbers where we could actually do some advertising. And I don't want to do it. But Chaille could actually make really good money if I start doing advertising. I'd rather you buy some merch or donate when I say that. Because I hate to be the guy that says, you know what, I'm going to turn down that money. That's, I would not even take. That would be for Chaille. We just get drunk and talk into microphones. This is not like this is a lot of out of my day. But we got to keep fucking Chaille in business. So buy merch or else. Stamps.what? And now back to the podcast, as I'm saying.
Walk right in and ride down and let it in your mind roll on.
Universe. Sex. Keep your balls off your legs and such.
Sex underwear. Don't have sweaty balls.
Was that good? I don't know. What's embarrassing is I think we just did 25 minutes about me bitching about a fucking glorious. What's that?
It's like 29 minutes.
29 minutes? Alright, we'll shave a few out. But the fucking... I remember the best Costa Rican vacations we ever took were staying at... Renee and I stayed at a place that was $9 a night in Costa Rica. And it was just like this surfer, two wooden benches, like a prison cell if they made prisons out of wood and it was on the honor system. And it was right there on the beach, and it had an outdoor shower that people shared what you wash your feet off with, but high enough you could get your hair if you cared to use shampoo. And most of those places in Tamarindo back before it was destroyed. And so, yeah, when you spend $150 on a place, all of a sudden you're a cunt. There was no coffee in that flop us. The $9 a night? Yeah. Didn't bitch about the coffee maker.
Yeah, but they didn't dangle coffee in front of you and then not have it.
Again, I did not find that shithole down there. That was what the whole point. I'm only going to book the initial hotel, which is low dollar, and that was the best one. And I figured I'd find cool places like we found in Costa Rica that you'd never find on Expedia.
You'd sniff it out once you got in town.
Yeah.
You'd meet a cool guy at the bar. He would say, you know where you need to stay. And then
right.
that but never happened.
Back in those days, we were partying a lot harder and taking more chances. Now, I just go, all right, this seat's comfortable. Well, we could go to that other place, but it's over across the parking lot. Fuck that. And while I was away, evidently you did a podcast. I don't know if that comes out before this one or after this one, if it's filler. But you did a Doug-less podcast without me because Mishka Shabali, who does the opening song generally, we've switched him out on occasion. Not on this one, since we're talking about him. Yeah, Mishka came down playing with JT Habersat and White Cotton.
They're currently on tour.
Yes.
And we'll post that in the show notes. But yeah. They're
JTStandup.com. See where they are. By the, no?
JTComedy.com.
Ah, fuck. Whatever.
JTComedy.com. They're actually going to be rolling through. They're done. They're in San
Just
Diego.
Just go to JT's. Yeah.
But they've got a lot of dates. They've got a ton of dates. Mishka's on a lot of them. And Jay White Cotton is on, I think, for the rest of the run. But yeah, you check that out. And we, Brett Erickson hosted three of the nights.
He's good.
Jay White Cotton?
No, Brett Erickson.
Brett Erickson.
He's good at hosting. He's a good host.
Okay.
Yeah, I heard you tore it up.
Yeah. I meant on the podcast.
Yeah, I never did drop that in, but
we went out to the Sierra Vista night and saw some of the Sierra Vista nightlife.
Sierra Vista is the close by town that's a military town. So
yeah, it's the one with a Walmart and
a
fort.
And a Best Buy.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's your
fort.
A fort.
Yeah.
Oh,
and
Wachuca,
it's got a Texas right? Roadhouse. If you want a really quality steak dinner with the family, and a big sign. Yeah, might have an Olive Garden.
Well, but, they had comedy one night.
And they didn't notice, I'm sure.
No.
No. That's definitely, that's Larry the Cable Guy territory.
I don't know. What was your read, Brett Erickson?
Who would be a military comic? I'm sorry, I'm stretching for references.
It's Carol Montgomery?
Carol Montgomery.
She does the USO.
Yeah,
you're thinking of Carol Channing.
No, Carol Montgomery. You wouldn't even know her.
You don't know her. But she does the USO, and they don't call it USO anymore. I think it's Armed Forces Entertainment, and she does a lot of she does the bases up in Anchorage as well. But he asked an Air Force or a military type act. That would be Carol Montgomery.
So here we did. Super Bowl happened. For the first time, I wasn't here, and you guys were.
Yeah. Yeah, it was, we had fun.
But you, Mishka and JT and you, Brett Erickson.
Yeah, they.
White Cotton, you did a show in town the night before Super Bowl.
Yeah, and that was a blast. Cafe Rocco was fun, and everybody in this town was fantastic. And then, and this was mentioned on the, so I'll just hit this briefly, because we talked about this on their podcast, but. Chaille and I and Tracy and Carrie Mitchell, the four of us were considering also not being here for Super Bowl, like finding our own little Super Bowl party somewhere else. So we were considering that. And then I kiboshed it because I'm like, well, hey, look, you know, I'm just meeting Mishka and JT and Jay White Cotton. I like them guys. I think it'd be kind of rude if they let me on their show two nights in a row. And then on Super Bowl Sunday, hey, fuck you guys. See you later. So I'm like, we can't just bail on these guys. We got to actually be here for the Super Bowl. So we kind of change our plans. We fucking hang out here for the Super Bowl. And then those guys eat a bunch of mushrooms, freak out, and hide in the fucking main house the whole goddamn time and never even poke their fucking heads out.
Never
so,
saw them.
Yeah.
Well, the only time you did see them was when you went up to the top of the fun house.
Yeah. So we're sitting down here watching the TV's on in the fun house and then the TV outside, and we're all sitting outside, and then I don't care about the game. I don't have a vested interest in these two teams. So I look up, and I see Gretchen and some of the other fun people. They're on top of the fun house. That looks like where the party is. So I go up there, and there's Mishka on one of the lounge chairs. Yeah, and JT is sitting right next to him. And then I look, and I realize, and they're like, hey, shh, quiet on the set, quiet on the set. And I look, and JT's got a fucking microphone in his hand with like a recording thing, and they're recording a fucking podcast on top of the funhouse during the Super Bowl. And Shaylee's right behind me, and we just start ripping on. I'm like, what the fuck? And you guys are in the van together all fucking day.
And now they're doing mushrooms? Day,
and now you're doing a fucking podcast.
Tripping on mushrooms.
Well,
the fuck?
See, I was ripping on them for doing a podcast, but then later I found out they were on mushrooms. So I rescinded my complaint, because when you're on mushrooms, then maybe that's fun. So, you know, I didn't know when I first was bitching at them for being on at a party and doing a podcast that they were tripping at that moment. So that turned out to be a reasonable
explanation. Well, I came home today, and it was 2 days of travel, because fucking Delta, as much as I love you, you fucking suck shit flying out of a small market to anywhere warm. So I had to fly out of fucking St. Martin to Atlanta, and there's a flight an hour and a half later. But since I have to go through customs legally, it's the window of time to get to that flight is too short. They can't sell you the ticket. So we had to stay overnight at a hotel in Atlanta and then get a flight home today. So it's 22 and a half hours plus the drive. So yeah, it's a full 24 fucking hours of traveling. And I finally get in, and the place is all nice. And I open up my bedroom, and JT and Mishka and all these stupid fucks just blew up like 8,000 balloons. So my bedroom is filled with balloons with a kooky note. The most inventive prank ever. Do you guys write for Jack Vale? If you don't know who that stupid cunt is,
Star of the new headline news show, Jack Vale Offline. He's got his own television program.
Oh, that's right.
It
followed the Dr. Drew show.
He was, he's so fucking awful that I have to stop myself. I just, for some reason, I have bloopers. It's just one of those Sunday morning Dean Superman guy hosts.
Yeah, Dean Cain.
And who doesn't like kicked in the nuts videos?
Right.
I am the guy from Idiocracy. I am fucking Dax Shepard.
Yeah, and Jack Vale is like, if the flavor vanilla was going to make fun of something for being lame, it would make fun of Jack Vale's program.
He's got a segment on Dean fucking Superman's bloopers that's syndicated on like Sunday morning. I don't know. I fast forward through it. I've probably seen all of them on, you know, Tosh.0 or something good. He's so bad and so fucking irritating that I have to stop myself. Because you don't want to hear from someone who hates your fucking guts, especially from within your industry on some level. And I have to fight myself. Like, really? That's all you could come up with for a prank? And you have 10 million fucking YouTube hits. So,
He walks past people and farts. That's one of his classics.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a fake fart machine.
It's not even a real fart.
Yeah.
Commit to the bit, cunt. Fart. Yeah, I'm going to see him eating a fucking greasy burrito before he, you know,
bad grandpa. Yeah, and then the extended version where he shits against the wall in a diner.
Now that's a prank.
That's funny. You can't even make farts funny. You suck so fucking much that the funniest thing in the world you ruin. And so my room is full of balloons because I have a phobia of sorts of balloons, which is just them being blown up, really. Just anything that could explode, or if they're fucking bouncing on a ceiling, if it might pop. It's the same as if someone holds a rubber band towards your face like this.
Waiting for them to let it go.
It's not going to kill you or, but it's that kind of.
The anticipation is.
So that's how I feel about balloons. So they fill up my room with balloons, which. It's not scary to me. Now it's just a fucking noise. My mother did this to me when I lived in L.A. and she lived two apartments down. And she thought it'd be cute because she'd go to the dollar store and hoard. There were all these like inflatable rabbits Easter rabbits
like
with
Mylar,
carrots.
The Mylar ones, or
just I don't remember what they were actually made of, but she filled up my apartment with them because she thought that would be funny. And when you get off the fucking road, like all that travel and shit, and now your apartment's full, like it's there's zero creativity to it. But in L.A., on that, you know, the apartment's a curse on. I just opened the door and I just chucked them over the fucking balcony. We used to say, we'll just put it out for the Russians. Because in West Hollywood, it's a gay and or Russian neighborhood. Never both, but gay or Russian. And they would scavenge. So you'd just be tired of something and you'd set it outside. We have tape of, like, what won't they take? Like, put a fish tank with a lubricated dollar bill or $5 bill, but smeared in Vaseline and watched the guy, like, pick it up and try to wipe. Like, just, they'd take anything. So within 15 minutes, 120 stuffed, blown up Easter bunnies are gone.
Gone.
Here, I how the fuck... I want to lay down at some point. My shit's, and you put my mail behind the balloons
before.
Yeah, so I had
I mean,
to
I'm,
go
I'm
through.
Not gonna, I'm not bailing out on the fact that I think it's funny that your mail was on that side. I just I wish I would have got all the mail back there, because you actually were able to enjoy some of the mail before you had to go.
So I went
balloons.
In with two knives and I just start stabbing, and I'm so physically awkward that. I'm like, I'm almost hitting myself in the thighs. If the balloon doesn't pop, like I'm getting more stabby. If they don't pop, and then I'm like, I'm going to fucking stab myself in the leg. So I have to really be careful. And
well, hitting
it sounds to me like the prank's getting good.
Well, hitting a balloon that's not held down, sometimes you will,
yeah, they
bounce around. And I thought that was a very possible scenario where you actually would cut yourself, and that's why I left.
it was really irritating.
Mission accomplished.
But no, what hurt the most is when you explained to me that they did this on mushrooms. They had all these balloons and they blew them up. Like, you wasted a fucking mushroom trip with the least creative Jack Vale prank. I just spent all that time. Like, if you were shit faced, I can imagine you go, it'll be funny. And then you go, oh, that was really stupid. You're tripping. You're fucking tripping your balls. Oh, man.
Yeah, there's coyotes. Yeah.
There's
lights,
so many levels to this.
Yeah. Yeah. They should have at least taken a shit inside of one of the balloons.
I did realize later I could have just fucking opened my bedroom window and just thrown them all straight out the window and they'd blow all over the neighborhood. And
for the Russians.
Yeah, everyone who's against the plastic bag ban.
There'll be an amendment for the Stanhope clause.
So that was my nice return home. Thankfully, your fucking lyrics are better than your pranks, Mishka. What else? Papa? I got a lot of... I tweeted that I'll now be accepting tweets via snail mail. Please include a self-addressed stamped envelope for a retweet. So I got a bunch of that and a bunch of other shit. Musicians and stuff sent some CDs and whatnot. I haven't been through all of it, but we'll listen to those and either plug them or throw them out the window.
So you tweeted for people to send you something.
I just said I'm now accepting tweets via snail mail at 212 Van Dyke Street, Bisbee, Arizona, 85603. And then you forget you did it. And then you go away for a couple weeks and then, so a lot of self-addressed stamped envelopes that are going to get someone else's mail remailed to them.
Hey, remember the...
And someone's getting 10 bucks.
Oh.
The guy who sent me 10 bucks said, buy a beer. Well, I'm going to retweet that to someone else.
The important part of the self-addressed stamped envelope is the stamped part.
Yeah, some guy forget to put a stamp on. But it's the whole point is I'll never go to the post office. If you go, hey, I live in fucking Hungary, and I'll give you $1,000 for a fucking autograph picture. I'm not going to go fill out fucking customs paperwork. That's such. Hey, this is where a stamps.com commercial could probably come in handy, but fuck them. I don't even know how that works. So yeah, that self-addressed stamped envelope thing. If I just have to stick it in a fucking envelope and go out to my mailbox, yeah, that's probably too much of a pain in the ass too, but I could talk Bingo into doing it. What else? I broke my fucking phone. My phone fell victim to alcohol-related domestic violence.
Nope.
Why?
Nancy Grace.
That was Nancy Grace-related domestic violence.
But it was
violence.
Alcohol-related.
Absolutely.
I would not watch Nancy Grace sober. I had to. Because I but did.
She was part of that. You can't. Yeah, she's not blaming.
It has to be Nancy Grace's fault because you're drunk every night, but you don't punch your phone
no,
to death.
No, there was something. No, because my fucking phone.
No, I'll tell you what happened.
I'll tell you what happened.
I'll tell you what happened. You were going to punch your computer.
Wait, hang on. We have to back up to the fact that my phone had some update that I was not allowed to not allow. Your phone's going to update. Shit's going to change. It's going to happen now or fucking, and then it just starts. I don't want you to fucking update. I want the fucking phone I bought. I don't want a new phone. If I want, I don't want to have to. It takes me so long to learn how to use the
Doug,
fucking
phone. Put the
phone
down. Put the phone down. Put it down. Just set it down. Phone. Set it down.
So step away for from some the reason, phone. During Nancy Grace, which I was only watching because I had to
the lead
call
in
to Dr. Yeah. Drew, who was on my side. It was a nice night. I was pretty drunk, but I don't think you could tell.
You know, it was a classy person. It was a champagne drunk, so it was a classy drunk. Yeah. It's harder to detect.
Yeah. So at some point, because of Nancy Grace and Dr. Drew that I had been watching and fighting with, I tried to do something on my phone, but that didn't work anymore because of the update. It put the autocorrect on, which, all of a sudden, duck country? No, fucking cunt.
Yeah.
And I smashed my phone. I didn't think I smashed it that hard, but it all went away.
I understand in the fog of what was happening at that moment, you don't realize you were almost through. You had the laptop, and you had lifted the laptop up, and you were going to smash it. And I grabbed it because
Doug smash.
There was something going on. We've been.
I have so many laptops. We brought old laptops that I've smashed out to the shooting range and just got footage of blowing them away with shotguns and all Joby's arsenal of fucking semi-automatic weapons.
You're like the drunk Hulk. Instead of getting like muscly and green, you're like wrinkly and gray, but just as angry.
We couldn't get internet access in one corner of a hotel in this shitty fucking hotel one time. And in the time that Doug walked in through the hotel, like through the door first, and then I had the bags come in and I turn around to shut the door, he had punched the screen and it just shattered. And then he just like, I'm going to go smoke. And that was like, I've done it. I've done it now. There's like nothing to
fucking Elvis with TVs.
You couldn't get in to make a fucking bet on like sportsbook.com or whatever your betting thing is. And you were fucking, you were trying to get something in. On
yeah,
a
it's definitely time dependent.
Yeah, definitely. But what happened was after the Nancy Grace, Dr. Drew thing on HLN, you had lifted the laptop up, your current laptop, and you were about to smash it. And I grabbed it, and then I was fixing whatever. You couldn't get past something. You just had to reboot it. It was not to.
Yeah, yeah.
Not to,
yeah.
Don't get
boring.
And at that point, I have it on my lap. And I look up and you have the phone, which has the update and you've been fighting with it. You were talking to the customer service and you were doing that whole fucking thing. And you basically, you did that thing where you're like, I'm going to smash it. And then you held back and then you went just straight down, face down onto your coffee table, which is thick wood, not forgiving. And it just, you picked it up and it was basically that same thing.
It almost did what is impossible. When someone like smashes a radio in a movie, and then it kind of goes, well, that doesn't affect the station.
Right. right.
But that's what my phone did. Like it showed parts of a screen and then those parts faded. And then it was
there was
just
one last sad face emoji. that like faded out.
Half face emoji, yeah. Splintered. Yeah. Yeah, it was, that was it. You picked it up and he's like, that's it. But there's nothing you can do at that point. You know, you're fucked. And you're leaving the next day to the Dutch Antilles.
Yeah, so I had to go to the AT&T store where Anthony didn't know fuck all about phones. He's as dumb as me. Put the wrong card in. I'm like, your SIM card thing. There's like two cards in it. I go, do I need the other card? Oh, you don't need that. And I'm like, I don't trust it.
Probably him. I do need that.
Well, so you kept that. You're an Android guy.
Yeah.
So just to give some.
So then I go back after because I immediately go to the Goodwill across the street, fucking see what's up. And
before you go to the airport to go to the.
Well, I left really early because that fucking AT&T store, it'll take them an hour to just sell a guy a fucking phone. It's almost as bad as buying a car. Like the amount of shit. So if there's three people in front of you, you're fucked. 2 hours.
Yeah.
So I left wicked early, and I was the only guy in the store, and it still took me almost a fucking hour with Anthony. And then I go turn on my phone over, and I'm waiting for it to, you know, everything's going to update and load. And I realize I have no numbers. Okay, why don't I? And I go back across the street. Anthony. Oh, and then do you still have that phone, the other
card?
You
have that other card?
Yeah, the one that you said I don't need? Yeah, I do. And that still only gave me. I'm pretty sure it's just the numbers I put on the SIM card since I had the phone I smashed before since I smashed the last phone before. So I'm missing a lot of numbers.
I just got lost. What the fuck?
If Doug's known you
for about 2 years, so anything I added in 2 years. Yeah. But if I knew, like Chaille, I didn't have Chaille in there. I didn't have Brett.
If Doug's known you more than three phone smashes ago, he does not have your number.
I don't have
anymore.
Your fucking number. So yeah, and I have that on my outgoing message. Hey, I fucking smashed my phone, so leave me your. But everyone texts you now, so I have a million text messages from phones.
And they say, my number is this, but they don't say who they are
right.
On the text?
Well, no. They don't get the, they text you, so they don't get the message.
Oh, yeah. I would never hear that.
Right. So that's my reason for not getting back to you. It's not like we talk anyway.
This is working out great. You need to be on like a once a year phone smash, like a schedule. Yeah. You'd be fucking down to like three numbers.
That one lasted forever. I had that one for a while. And yeah, that last computer I smashed, I thought I learned my lesson.
But you know, we were over at the safe house, and you have a lot of computers that just are laying around. We need to, like you said, you go to the range. You need to, there's in the crawl space.
But you fixed a bunch of them, and
you did nothing with them.
Well, you labeled them. That's why I said we can have one of those just set up. To leave up for that fucking sound thing you have going on with the Spotify or something?
Yeah, yeah.
So that way it gets rained on.
Let's give credit. It's Sonos, the Sonos wireless system.
You don't have to give them credit. You paid for it.
Yeah, fuck them.
Give them a plug.
All right.
Wait a minute. Let's give them a plug if Doug doesn't smash his phone after he tries to play a song.
Yeah, then it'll work.
That will be the test.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for setting up all my iPod shit that... I right after the balloons, he's telling me how now I can play all these things. I'm burned out. I'm burned out anyway. And right through the door, I gotta go pop balloons, and then you're gonna try to explain to me how to work a sound system.
I knew it was going nowhere right when I.
I had not nearly enough dumb shit to watch on my DVR to fucking tone me down to let me come out here. Bar Rescue. There's a fucking Bar Rescue. I'm like, oh, Bar Rescue's back on. It was a 2-minute teaser, but somehow my DVR fucking recorded you fucking.
I got tricked the same way on the DVR the other day because I saw, oh, Better Call Saul is already on my DVR. It's already happened. I fucking missed the. And it was the same thing. It was, oh, hey, it's going to be on next week.
A preview.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't fucking
I do appreciate the fact that you're letting me know because nothing sucks worse than like, oh, fuck, I forgot to record that. Because so many shows that you watch come out every 18 months.
Mm-hmm.
You know, fucking Boardwalk Empire.
The cycles. It used to be you could get used to when the NBC, ABC, CBS,
yeah, the fall.
You would have the cycles. You right. would be used to, I don't know, what the fuck are they?
Yeah, and they all do 39 fucking shows a season. Yeah. So it yeah, they lasted go, all the way till May.
17th episode, not episode, but series, season. That's what I'm looking for. You go, it's only been on for 7 years. Well, the season.
It's half a season.
They did two or three seasons in a calendar year.
Yeah.
It could be. Yeah.
We're breaking up the last season of Mad Men into four seasons. Each season will be half of a show. Enjoy it.
Can't believe fucking not only is General Hospital still on.
Not my only, wife is still watching it at the house right now.
Yeah. Because when we're loading up for Deathpool, and she mentioned fucking Luke and Laura, and I'm like, I remember that from when I was like 11.
1983, I believe?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's when that was. I mean, General Hospital's been on.
No, no.
Yeah, but the big Luke and Laura.
The Luke,
thing.
Yeah. Luke's still around. Yeah.
The marriage.
What we're talking about is the fact that my girlfriend wife is still heavily addicted to General Hospital.
And that guy's still on it. She has to watch it every fucking day.
He's the main dude, man. He's and not only that, this is what they're doing right now. This is their storyline right now. Is that he's not only is he still on it, but there's bad guys who have super elaborate Luke masks and they look just like him and they're doing some crazy sketchy shit. And Luke's trapped somewhere else. The real Luke.
Hidden? Like, this like is kidnapped or something?
Yeah. How fucking bad can this podcast get? First I complain about my fucking about overpriced.
Hold on. What's going on with Luke?
You have to watch the show, you guys. Shit. Some deep shit going on.
I did not get
Charles.
A good enough tan in the Dutch Antilles, and now what's happening on General Hospital? This is the fucking biting humor that this sent me into a fucking
You really
trailer.
Are the edgy comic we've heard.
Do it. Tear apart Days of Our Lives. Go for it right now.
Hang on.
Give us 5 minutes on Days of Our Lives.
That's over.
Is that still on?
No, I think General Hospital is the last one on, isn't it?
I don't know.
I only say that because I thought the last one that was on was gone. I thought there were no more soap operas years ago because they made a big deal. I know.
Yeah,
what
they got rid of all my children and some of the other ones.
Erickson, how do you, I mean, God bless you, man. How do you fucking, how can you stand that?
What do you
like,
mean?
That is on. And you know that there's
Do you realize
a
how
match?
Much fuck? Yeah, but listen.
There's something you could be watching.
Watching fucking a bunch of guys from England kick a fucking ball around for 90 minutes is every bit as stupid as watching General Hospital.
Fucking Arsenal Tottenham tomorrow.
Yes. Yes, that's a big one. Yes. The Hotspur.
I'm a fucking Hotspur
that's
guy.
That's the North London
one.
Derby.
What's Hotspur?
Tottenham
that's,
Hotspur.
That's their mascot. Yeah,
occasionally
it's a bird,
they
dummy.
Have a mascot.
It's a bird.
Over
it's
there.
A bird.
So yeah, I'm fucking Tottenham tomorrow. Do you have a team on that? Do you have
a dog
in that fight?
No, I don't have a dog in that fight. I'm definitely when it comes to Tottenham Arsenal, I'm definitely a Tottenham man.
All right,
because
well,
I'm anti Arsenal,
and I will be. The late game is
Liverpool Everton, which is the Merseyside derby, and some serious shit, people.
Everyone knows that.
Everybody
don't state
knows
the obvious.
Well, Liverpool is the big team, and then Everton's the other team in Liverpool. So there ones. It's the Merseyside derby because the River Mersey cuts through Liverpool, and one team's on one side, one's on the other. They fucking hate each other.
Hey, UK, fucking follow some at Brett Erickson 68.
Yeah, I'll make fun
That's
of your
Erickson
stupid
with a
football team.
Okay. Well, you know, generally I would say Everton for sure on that, but I'm going Liverpool because I know the filthy uncut Scotsman is an Everton fan for whatever reason and hates the coach. So anything
he hates
Hennigan
the coach
likes,
of Liverpool.
I'm,
and he used to love the coach of Everton, David Moyes, because David Moyes was Scottish. So that's the only thing he cares about.
All I
so
care
that's why
about
he's in Everton.
Is man. Fucking whoever Hennigan's for, I'm against. So go Liverpool. Hate the Beatles, but I think your team
I saw
can make
this,
up for it.
Speaking of Liverpool, they're big. They have a song they sing all the time, and their motto is "You'll never walk alone." And they sing this song, "You'll never walk alone." The whole stadium sings it every fucking game, and blah blah blah. Well, I guess, and I don't know how factual this actually is, but there's a picture of a guy who's an English soldier who got like his leg blown off in fucking Syria or somewhere, and he had a Liverpool tattoo that said, "You'll never walk alone," but the part of his leg that got blown off is the alone part. So now he just says, "He will never walk." So I don't even know if it's a true, like, it might be just a photoshopped funny idea someone had, but I laughed fucking hard when I saw it. I'm like, if that isn't a real thing, someone needs to write it into a goddamn movie. That was fucking beautiful.
General Hospital. Luke.
Yeah, Luke will do that next episode.
Plugs.
Here I go.
God damn it. The Dream Bar. Here's my ears. Okay. Oh, well, of course, the first plug is the podcast. Ggreg, Chaille. Keep Ggreg, Chaille doing the podcast. We got signed posters, merch, t-shirts, other shit.
Merch? You have the Brett Erickson CD merch available on your website?
We could if you had any.
Wow. Oh, I have a bunch of them.
I'm selling everything. Everything must go. That's all I have to do is fucking take one overpriced vacation.
There's the picture of the guy's leg blown off with the "You'll never walk alone," but it's hard to read, but the alone part's gone.
If that's Photoshop, that's damn.
It looks real, right?
Yeah, that's real.
So back to merch.
Yeah, back to merch.
We've got the Last Gasp tour posters while they last. You're signing them as long as the orders come in. We'll do that.
Yeah, whatever else you come up with to sell, fucking furniture. Gotta get rid of this. These fucking cocksuckers. At one point, I was on the road and they put a couch in my house.
They took out a couch and put a couch in there.
Yes, they replaced the thrift store couch that no one ever sat on. That was just a clothes dumping spot.
And
replaced it somewhere. Someone found a Last Supper couch, which by the time, don't even fucking email me going, "I want it." It was a mural of the Last Supper, a full size couch, shitty. It's actually a day bed. It was a mattress.
It's a mattress, yeah.
That someone made a tapestry of the Last Supper as that it's wrapped in, whatever. The upholstery is the Last Supper, and the backdrop is also the Last Supper, the back of the couch. And then finally, I'm like, we're getting rid of this fucking thing. Put it outside for the Super Bowl for the outside TV. And after that, it's going by the dumpster and leave it out for the Russians. Only here, they're not Russian at all. Sinoidans.
Let's put it on eBay.
Oh, yeah. Shipping cost.
I'll ship that fucking thing.
Craigslist.
I'll ship it.
Put it on fucking Craigslist.
Why not eBay? Doug Stanhope's Last Supper couch?
That thing weighs like 800 pounds.
Don't worry about that.
It's all yours, my friend. You are the Russian. You just fucking bought a couch for nothing.
No, I didn't buy a couch. I'm selling a couch.
I know.
It's going to be on eBay.
I'm saying
it's Doug
yours.
Stanhope's Last Supper. You have to sit on the couch for the picture. Doug Stanhope's.
I'll do it Burt Reynolds style. Bourgeois 1975.
Fuck yeah,
Carrie
you will.
Carrie Mitchell and I actually need a couch, so...
No.
It's
we might be sleeping. We might be sleeping on that couch, so you're going to get a good couch.
You'll get a good couch.
Not to say that the Doug Stanhope Last Supper couch is not a quality fucking mattress.
I'm pretty sure you just said that it wasn't.
I just
actually.
Said it. It's horrible.
I'm selling it. eBay. So
you sell it. Yeah. You need the money. I need the money. That's, again, every fucking time I try to retire, I do one dumb thing like fucking take a vacation and spend. Wait. We had to give the fucking Dream Bar at that last hotel, and I can't. It's
the third hotel
with the no elevator, the Allegria at Maho Beach. Fucking scumbags.
The no coffee in the coffee maker.
No elevator.
No elevator. Okay.
Yeah.
No, I'm just trying
ice
to keep track.
Bucket. Yeah. They.
The Allegra
point?
Means happy, by the way.
You had to give them at the Dream Bar.
Allegria. Oh, the Dream Bar, which is a cool part of the Allegria.
Oh, Allegria means no coffee. Sorry. Just thought you
should tell you. The Dream Bar. The fucking Marty and Lori that own it. We gave away two bottles of vodka.
that we had from, we got duty-free thinking, oh, yeah, we'll make our own drinks, sneak down to the beach. We never did any of that. We sat and bought their fucking $7 fucking drinks. And then at the end, gave them all of our vodka. We're not going to bring it back.
Yeah, you can't take it back, right? Yeah.
Not without checking it.
And then they charged people $7 a drink.
Yeah, what did like a rum and coke, like a regular
$7?
Really?
Yeah,
fucking nailed it.
Well, see, he just said it.
Oh,
yeah, I just
pay
said
attention.
It.
Oh, sorry, I was writing.
Your
down.
Honor, he's leading the witness.
I was writing down the Dream Bar and the Allegria.
Yeah, so yeah, the Dream Bar and the Dirty Sanchez in Phillipsburg. Oh. That was the first bar. That's where they pulled the guy out by ambulance.
The Dirty Sanchez.
Yeah.
Mm.
And the first hotel, it was a dump. This was a beautiful thing. It was not a dump, but I got fucking copious notes. You'll find all this shit on Yelp eventually. At one point, it's no smoking. The only one that really said or enforced no smoking in the room. It was a dump, and there was no remote for the TV, and the bedside lamp didn't work. And I got to read. You know, that's the one thing I'd like is the lamp to work.
Electricity is good.
So I wasn't a dick or anything, but I called up and they sent a guy up, and he's this fucking monster, fucking that scary Caribbean black, that fucking murder in your eyes, fucking, and it's not even like a racist thing.
Island thing.
Yes,
it's a scary thing.
It's a fucking. I smell weakness.
Yeah,
it's like when Henry Phillips, my dog Henry Phillips, not the comic, looks at you with those King Kong eyes.
Yeah,
like oh, she's
like prison.
You fucked up now, buddy.
It's prison yard. You know who to.
Yeah, it's a whole different fucking story. And he came up smiling, which is even more off-putting. And he's like 7 feet tall. And I go, he's like, what's the problem? I go, there's no remote, and I'm smoking outside on the deck, not deck, but the fucking walkway. It's like a motel.
Right.
And I point to the lamp that doesn't work. I'm standing outside, but my cigarette is in my pointing hand, and I point, and the lamp doesn't work. He goes, no smoking in the room, sir. My hand just crossed the door jamb to point at the lamp, and he lays down the fucking no smoking rule.
Oh.
Like, oh, you just fucked up.
That's $250.
Yeah. God knows. Last time, the only other fucking time I've been to the Caribbean was Nassau, because it was the only place I could get to on Delta that I didn't have to fucking overnight. One way or the other.
That was recently, though, right?
It was last year.
Okay, yeah.
And, I went there, and I fucking got suckered into the free lunch timeshare fucking proposal. And I said, hey, bingo, let's just fuck with them, because you can't get from the front of the casino to your room without them fucking with you every single time. Come on, man, when are you going to get the free lunch, man? And let's just get the free lunch and fuck with them. And then within 10 minutes, I'm like, it's not even worth fucking with them. But by then, they've already got a copy of my credit card. And when I got home, somewhere when I was drinking in Nassau, I bought $6,700 worth of ceramic floor tile.
Oh, nice.
Now, I've done some crazy things when I was drinking, but I think I'd remember $6,700 worth of ceramic floor tile.
Those will look good in the rape trailer.
So
all two tiles.
Yeah. So God knows what I'll get for fucking leaning a cigarette over a door jam of the Seaview Beach Motel. We'll get to all that and Uncle Diddley. So yeah, that was that's that. I remembered Rob, that guy I met at the Dirty Sanchez that day, that your wife kindly took off her Sinesta bracelet so we could try to cheat them. We tried, but we went to the wrong one, and that's that. We'll have shit online. Anything else we need to talk about? Everyone's giving me shit about this fucking rehab.
There's a lot of chatter.
Yeah, there's a lot of chatter. We have to figure out a plan. See how long you guys are in town.
I'm getting the fuck out of here as soon as that happens, dude. Honestly. That doesn't interest me at all.
Yeah, I'm not starting until you leave. So
that's a good idea.
It's kind of a fucking Mexican standoff here.
Who's going to break first?
But so far, I still have nothing on the calendar. So yeah, every plan can be reconnoitered, but I got to start soon. I get to the point where just that day drinking leading into night drinking. Usually, all right, if we're going to day drink here, I know at 7 o'clock I'm just going to take a fucking Xanax and fall asleep to Netflix and then just watch Netflix. On vacation, I was like, oh, you have to day drink and night drink, and that's all you're going to do. And I got to the point where I can't think of any kind of alcohol I could stomach right now. I fucking flew home sober, kind of.
You know, the irony is you left here, the compound in Bisbee, Arizona, and flew 17 hours to the Caribbean, the Dutch Antilles,
yes,
to do exactly what Brett and I have been doing since you fucking left.
I know, it was pointless. Yeah, absolutely. I had fucking plans. I'd walk the beach and shit, but the beach wasn't walkable. You could see from one end to the other, and then it turns into rocks.
There's not a speck of sand on you right now. You don't even fucking have a tan. I have more of a tan from sitting out under these beautiful fabricated palm trees than you do, and you went somewhere to get a tan.
Yeah, the fucking bar, they put the awning down.
Yeah.
They like cranked down the awning. I'm like, I'm getting sun on my back. Like, why are you cranking the awning down? Fucking cranky
because
Dutchman.
You went to a hotel with a bunch of old people and they all have melanomas. They need to get the sun off themselves.
Yeah,
and they don't know what sunblock is.
I don't feel like I missed anything by not going out. It was one of those, like, all right, we drove around, I looked out the windows, I can profile it. Yeah, I didn't miss anything. Oh, you should see the French side. Why? Because there's a t-shirt shop next to a fucking
they're more
bar
rude over
next
there
Yeah, so that was that. Thank you very much for listening. Wasn't even planning on doing a podcast, but you got one anyway. So quit your bitching. We'll fucking set up something good before I go into the rehab. Play something. You know what? I was going to... Here, play this. This is depressing. I fucking love this song. We've never played this, and no one knows it. It's... This is the original song I hate, but this version is Warren Zevon doing Back in the High Life by Stevie Winwood. This is a fucking monster. That's a good
where's
song.
Where's your phone? Give me your phone.
This is a song.
Give me your phone. The Sonos system. I'm going to play it for us right now, but I'll put it in.
All right. Well, this is the perfect song for me to be going into a fucking 6x12-foot trailer for 30 days to quit smoking and pseudo rehab. Keep that crashing tin can sound in there.
Yeah, I really like Warren Zevon's take. It sounds great.
I gotta figure out how to work this thing. Hold on a second. Oh, here we go. It should be on here.
Mm-hmm.
This mobile device. Hold on. This is how quick it is, guys. Come on, Warren.
I bet it'll come up in my fucking contacts. Wait, I had his number? I can't find the song, but
Warren
Zevon
called
his phone
me?
Number.
Playing.
Oh man.
No, I have
fucking
it.
Sonos. Do we turn it down? Turn the volume all the way down?
Oh fuck.
Way to go, dumb dumb.
No. It's saying God damn it. It's saying that you don't have the digital rights to play.
He's well, dead.
I'll get it off Spotify. Oh. Hold on. What album was it on?
Lawyers, Guns, and Money.
You're just saying.
Hey, this is Doug Stanhope on the Doug Stanhope Podcast. I'm looking for a new tech guy. If you're under, say, 40 years old and talk like you know how to fix everything and can.
That's discrimination. You just entered my age into it.
Yeah. Ageism. That's ageism. Ageism.
Jesus, you empty your ashtrays every now and then, you fucking pig smoke.
It used to seem to me that my life ran on too fast, and I had to take it slowly just to make the good parts last. But when you're born to run, it's so hard to just slow down. So don't be surprised to see me in the brighter part of town. And I'll be back in the high life again. All the doors I closed one time will open up again. I'll be back in the high life again. All the eyes that watched me once will smile and take me in. And I'll drink and dance with one hand free, let the world back into me. Oh, I'll be a sight to see, back in the high life again. Best, make life be real to me. And I hope that you're still out there, you're like you used to be. Have ourselves a time, we'll dance till the morning sun. But let the good times come, we won't stop until we're done. And we're back in the high life again. All the doors I closed one time will open up again. We'll be back in the high life again. All the eyes that watched us once will smile and take us in. And we'll drink and dance with one hand free, have the world so easily. Oh, we'll be a sight to see, back in the high life. We'll be back in the high life again. All the doors I closed one time will open up again. We'll be back in the high life again. All the eyes that watched us once will smile and take us in. Back in the high life.
You're live.
Oh, no, I was just catching up on news since I've been away, and Warren Sapp, I got a tweet. Evidently, Warren Sapp heard your bit about the transvestite hookers, and I'm like, oh, fuck, what happened there? But, like, I'm on my phone, so I didn't want a news search, but then I found that story. It was in Phoenix, so that's
another tie-in.
Yeah, beat up some hookers or something. I like Warren Sapp. It's almost as heartbreaking as the Brian Jennings, or is that
Bruce Jenner?
No, Brian Williams.
Brian Williams, Brian, the NBC.
Brian Jennings. How did I get fucking Jennings out of that? Why are we recording any of this?
This isn't recording.
We're just fucking talking.
Brian Williams lied about the Iraq, something that happened to him in the Iraq War. And he should be thrown in jail, because that's what we do to people who lie about the Iraq War. We throw them in jail where they belong.
But not the people who start the Iraq War.
You see, you didn't get the joke. Those people who started the Iraq War also lied about the Iraq War, and no one cares. All right.
Oh.
I'm glad this isn't going out.
Yeah, I don't know why we're recording this, but
I just wrote this down.
This would be a fun thing to do for the because for the 30-day rehab, wherever I do it.
The tin can rehab, I think, is what it's been.
Yeah, but I might fucking move it over to that other house where I actually have access to shit like a
toilet.
Yeah, stuff like that.
Refrigerator.
Yeah, so I don't have an excuse for snapping, like waking up at 6 a.m. freezing my balls off because it's some weird fucking
I think that'd be
cold
great
streak, and then I go fuck this.
But for every pod, because I want to do a 15-minute podcast every day for 30 days.
How long?
Just whatever, 10, 15 minutes every day.
Oh, 15. I thought you said 50.
10 to 15 minutes, whatever. Yeah. A short podcast every day. But it would be fun to do a battle of the obscure Doug Stanhope's iPod bands to open and close. Like just all the weird shit no one's ever heard that's on my iPod. That
the stuff gets handed off at the merch
booth. The stuff that I put on a
here.
Fucking iPod at my iPod at a party. And then within three songs, someone's going, what the fuck?
Yuck. Oh,
is
your
this?
Actual picks.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
To open and close, and we could do brackets somehow. I don't know how it works.
Like a March Madness sort of fucking.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, yeah. We could, 16 seed against a one seed.
We could do a voting. So, like, if you're going to do a 1 15 minute podcast every day for 30 days, really? If you want to do that, every day you
well,
produce
I can
one.
Do 32 days, and then it's 64, and we can do actual brackets. Fucking fleshing
yeah.
this out
no,
right in front of
no,
you.
No, this is great. Because what we can do is we release the podcast in the morning, and we'll set it up so it goes out every morning, and then we can do a voting.
But, okay, hang on. Yeah, you do a voting.
Through WooBox on Facebook.
All right.
Done.
Okay, but.
No math on our part.
All right, then what I'll have to figure out the brackets. So instead of like east, west, north, south, it would be like faggy, like
death
jock
metal.
Rocky, wicked obscure, and
yeah.
something else.
So
and,
four, you need four categories.
Music from people who actually handed me their CD at the end of a show.
Right.
Well,
friends.
We'd have to go
yeah,
back and
friends.
We'd have to go back and find those.
Not a lot of that shit.
Some of it.
That's
yeah,
how I found Mishka. That's a fucking Molotov jukebox. I only found them randomly because we did a BBC radio Sunday morning thing that they have a comedian and a musician and a guy and everyone talks in a round table and they were the band and they all go out and get shit faced afterwards at noon on Sunday. And you're like, well, it sounds great to me.
You fell in love.
I fucking still am in love with that lady.
Did she play the accordion?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what it was. Yeah.
Mama's got a squeeze box.
Yeah, yeah.
Fuck it.
And Doug likes
filthy
the squeeze
girl.
Box. Yeah.
Filthy girl.
No, you could smell her through the YouTube clip.
Fucking,
patchouli and B.O.
And rum.
And oh, I was wondering what the
rum
liquor du
pussy.
Jour was. Rum and pussy? Yeah. Isn't that a new Calvin yeah, Klein fragrance? Rum and pussy?
Yeah. Unwashed hippie pussy. But that somehow she makes it sound good.
No, it's fucking beautiful. Are you that
Bingo,
song?
Bingo
that song
says
is a
she's
smile.
The fucking sexiest woman she's ever seen in her life, and pictures don't do her justice. But
that song "Double Dare" is a fucking smile through your ears. It's awesome, and that girl,
that's
she's
probably
famous.
The gayest thing you've ever said.
No, I've said
and,
gayer,
and you've said gayer. This is one thing you missed, Doug.
Blow off in my ass.
While we were while you were gone,
no come in. Me.
While we were gone, we went to Sierra Vista. We went. I wanted to make some t-shirts for the Cafe Rocas show, so we had to go to Joanne Fabrics to get like press on transfers.
That's the gayest thing you've ever.
Okay,
said.
Wait. It gets gayer.
It gets gayer.
So we walk into Joanne Fabrics.
You don't have to tell the story. He wasn't
we
here.
We walk into Joanne Fabrics, and Chaille and I are and, you know, Tracy and Carrie Mitchell are like behind us, like 20 feet, like women should be when men are walking. So we walk
in Joanne Fabrics.
Into Joanne Fabrics. So we walk
men
into
lead the way into Joanne
in
Fabrics.
We walk into Joanne Fabrics, and then immediately on the in the aisle is a display of
it's
a
called
tiny,
the point of sale. It's right when you walk in. It's an impulse buy.
You're off point right now. So there's these tiny little mason jars, and as we're walking past, Chaille stops me, and he grabs my arm, and he goes, oh, these would be perfect for those little cakes I make. I was like, what the fuck, dude?
You know what?
And they would be, by the way. His cakes are delicious.
Aren't they
all,
delicious?
First of all, the fact that you had to put the affectation of that.
No, that's
took
how
away
he said
from
it.
He didn't lisp when he said it. You just
or grab your arm. We were holding hands.
I can imagine him grabbing your arm.
I grabbed the half pint, the four half pint box of mason jars. And I said, these would be perfect for those little cakes.
You said it with way more excitement than that.
First of all, I definitely was excited.
I wasn't trying to fag it up, but you were very, very excited.
Why don't we start this as a collage of the Marilyn Manson podcast. Just we get to pull tracks and just drop them. I don't know if we do it all at once. Or we just drop them in occasionally
from your 4-hour Marilyn Manson.
No, he does. He's not even talking about that. The 4-hour.
Yeah,
Marilyn...
that's what I'm talking about.
Oh, really?
No, just pull out pieces of it.
Get Laura Kimball to tell us what parts to put in. She's the only person that's heard it, and I tuned out after the first hour.
That's why it would be funny to just take non sequiturs to drop in.
Yeah, don't even listen to them first. Just take a chunk at random and say, all right, we're going to listen to
chunk. It's in my fucking notes of things to do while doing a 30-day fake rehab.
Here's how we could do the hidden track thing. Yeah, they'll know the overall time, and they'll know it's still there. But if you put in there a long enough silent pause, you just make people fucking wait.
No, that's like, Dramarama did that. They had back when tracks for CDs, they would have all the tracks, and then every second was another track. So it was 110 tracks on this one album, and at the end was a song called "You're Still Here."
Right. See? But if you make someone listen to 5 minutes of silence to hear the rambling, drunken bullshit that's the, quote, hidden track, then at least they – because most people, even if they know it's there because they know the runtime, they're 3 minutes into silence. They're like, well, fuck this. I'm done.
So right now they're like punching their podcast machine because they're listening to this.
They won't even be able to listen to Bill Burr.
What's the payoff? What's the payoff after sitting through 5 minutes of silence, Mr. Stanhope?
Us pretending we're listening to Gogo Bordello when it was really a different band and we didn't even know. That's funny. It's not funny. It's sad.
I have to go through my goddamn iPod and find 64 songs I can pit against each other.
Oh, easy. That you've got everything on 3 computers.
I got like Tim Curry. No one fucking knows Tim Curry.
Yeah, no, that's one that always plays.
The actor?
Oh,
whenever
you know
we have
what?
A PA set up here.
Assholes, your time has come. It was one of the best stories ever that I've probably told before. Guy fucking actually emailed me and said, stop saying you probably said this before. We listen to your albums over and over again. Who gives a fuck? Thank you, that guy. You gave me confidence. Rare burst of email confidence. Do you know the story?
Shouldn't you save it for when you do that song, when you pit that song against another one?
No, because no one's going to listen to this.
This is a hidden track. It's a hidden track, dude.
We're not recording.
There's a movie by Tim Curry with Tim Curry called Times Square. Fucking would have been straight to video if video existed. 1980 or 81.
It was straight to trash can back then.
And there was one greatest soundtrack ever. It's got fucking Joe Jackson, Patti Smith, people I would have never heard of if it not for that movie. And there's a song by the two characters that's part of the movie. It's kind
of
like
it's actually in the plot of the movie that the song is.
Yeah, what was the two chicks in the mental institution with Winona Ryder?
The girls.
Heathers?
No, Heathers.
I'm thinking of one on a ride.
No, two girls and they escape. It's like that earlier.
Yeah,
and they're whatever it is. It's like that, but from the 1980s and it stunk. And one girl is a daughter of a mayor and the other girl is this punk rock cutter chick and they escape and they're on the lam and it's the mayor's daughter, so it's a big kerfuffle. And the one girl's a punk rocker, so they make this punk rock song. And it's spick, nigger, faggot, bum, your daughter is one. That's the name of the song is Your Daughter Is One. And it's only part of the movie because they play it. Tim Curry's the DJ that lets him on the air. It's a stupid movie. But there's one like riff in between lyrics where the dirty girl in the song says, assholes, your time has come because I'm a time bomb and I'm going to explode all over you people. Spick, nigger, faggot.
Banjo Randy.
Peoria, Illinois. Yeah. Jukebox fucking comedy club. Banjo Randy. You're on stage. I'm with Banjo Randy in the green room. Oh, it's before the show. What's his name? The fucking idiot is piping the people up, and it's hecklers. Maybe you were on stage.
Maybe I was the idiot.
You were the idiot.
Maybe I was the idiot. It's
anyway,
possible.
I know it's just it's a like chaos show of yelling and screaming, and I'm back fucking pumped up, and Banjo Randy's gonna come up and play with me, and I just said to myself, assholes, your time has come, and Banjo Randy finished it.
Yeah.
Say, because I'm a time bomb. I'm going to explode. Nobody in the world has seen this movie. If I met Tim Curry and said, you know what? I loved you in that movie. He wouldn't
remember
doing that movie. And Banjo Randy, the most obscure lyric that you could ever imagine, knew the fucking lyric. Black eyes to you, fucking Nazi. It's a good... I'm sticking pins in your brain. I'm manslaughtering you with voodoo. Can you hear the drums? Do you feel the pain yet, faggot social worker? And Mr. Pearl, you with every rotten tooth in my head. Black eyes to you, fucking Nazi. Pins into you, sleaze sister voodoo. That's the boring part. That's it.
I think
the mayor's daughter.
I think assholes, your time has come would make a great Doug Stanhope special.
That's the new one. Not written yet.
It's weird. We have Fleischmann's plastic jug. We have Crown Roos plastic jug. And Vitali plastic jug, and they're all open, but none of them are finished. Like, people are going,
yeah. I'll try something else.
Yeah.
So we've got, so far, the extra podcasts after the closing song, Marilyn Manson clips from the 4 hours.
Yeah.
That I'll pull randomly.
I don't think you listened to it to try to pick something. I think you
No,
randomly,
I tried. I tried to find something
really
interesting.
The reason it would be okay, really
hey,
funny.
You know what? I'll tell you what. I'll give it to you to listen to, and you tell me
no,
what
I'm
to
not.
Play.
I'm not arguing with you about this. I'm saying that you don't have to listen to it. You just randomly select a time. You go
no,
four,
no, no,
1 hour no. and 22 minutes, 15 seconds to 1 hour, 22 minutes and 47 seconds. Here's what that sounded like.
My point is that I have 30 days
to kill. Absolutely.
So I can listen to it. And just go, all right.
Oh, yeah. All right.
From fucking, you know, the 12:24 mark to the 14:48 mark. There's 2 minutes of fucking weirdness. Play that.
Okay. And then vote on songs, brackets. I love that.
All right. Hidden tracks.
Hidden tracks. What do you mean? Oh, extra podcast.
What we're doing right now.
Hidden track.
These are possible.
This won't air.
This
also,
podcast should be called This Won't Air.
Also,
that's a great idea.
Actually, I wrote down straight to trash can from
straight
earlier.
Straight to trash can.
I was watching John McCain at that hotel at the Atlanta airport this morning. I mean, he's talking about whatever ISIS or fucking something. And like that guy's like 80 years old, and he's still like coherent and vibrant and vital.
It's your congressman.
And I go, I could just not drink. Like, if I just didn't drink, I'd probably be smarter and get stuff done just by not drinking. Like, how easy would it be to go, oh, okay, just don't drink? And I'd probably just get into a groove. And then,
you'd be so productive.
Yeah.
You'd hate yourself.
Then I hit the airport bar. Bingo got that first class seat. I thought for sure she'd have forgotten the bet.
Which
like,
was?
Fuck it. That she gets all.
She gets the first
all,
class.
If I get bumped up.
He gets one. She gets the rest.
She bet three against one and she fucking beat me.
So basically your 12-step program was you figuring out that you're going to probably become smarter by not drinking.
And for a minute, I went, well, because it's morning and I've been day and night drinking for a whole vacation.
From the curb to the bar, you came up with a plan. And then right when you hit the threshold of the bar, within line of sight, you decided, fuck that.
Yeah.
That's good.
Well, no. We get to the Sky Club where it's free. That's the problem. First class. Would you like a drink before we take off? Oh, and those cunts can't? Yes. I have to.
Two. Not to mention your gallon thing with 12 airplane shots.
I didn't
even
bring a traveler, but I did actually start drinking back in coach. But I paced it. An hour a drink. I had a drive. At one point, hey, is this bullshit or not? So I fucking get up at that last hotel one night. I'm pissing and I noticed this fucking powder fucking chopped up on the back of the toilet tank.
Where are you at?
The last hotel.
In Maho Beach.
The one with...
The no coffee maker, no oil.
Dutch Antilles. Allegria.
So Bingo's got all sorts of back fucked up. So she's got Valiums. And I go out and she's, been erratic, but you never know when she's been like fucking day drinking all day when you were saying, oh, just go to breakfast by yourself. And she had 17 cocktails or you don't know. So, but she went to bed at like 3 p.m. and now it's like 2:30 in the morning and she's been out the whole time. And I go, honey, have you been chopping up your Valiums and snorting them? No. Oh, this fucking chopped up white powder on the back of the toilet tank, and we've been here for 2 days.
with no room service. You've had no people coming in, no cleaning. There's no cleaning. Yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't let Scandinavians into my room to fucking clean my room, much less those fucking murder eyed fucking Caribbean Negroes. Someone tweeted me that Stanhope must really be retired because on his last podcast, he referred to some kid as a half nigger. That's just because it was Hack. It was talking to Hack Oddity.
Right. Who
not only do we call a half nigger, refers to himself as a half nigger or a half faggot, depending. And it was like, all right, he was a half ginger, half nigger like you, because you only have gingers. The point is,
what is the point?
The point is the fucking Caribbean blood-sucking Negroes.
So the powder on the back
are
of the...
equal to Scandinavian housekeepers.
In your eyes.
In my eyes. I would not. So she swears no. And then the next morning, afternoonish, she comes out kind of drunk. I'm reading my book. I'll be down. It's only 12:30. I got 40 pages left in this book. I'll be down to the bar. And why are you bleeding from the nose?
Side note, like Columbo.
And she's got blood coming out of her nose. And she wipes it with her finger like this and goes, I'm not bleeding from the nose. I go, there's blood on your finger now. Look at it. She goes, no, there's not.
You can't argue with that.
And then she goes back in and comes right back out. And there's on the other side of the same nostril, blood is coming out again. I go, you're bleeding from the nose again. Were you picking at something? Yeah, I was picking at something. I go, honey, were you chopping up your Valium and snorting them the same as I had asked her the night before? She went, yeah. And I go, I asked you that last night. She goes, I swear to God, that wasn't me.
So she's still.
She got
the idea from you.
That's what she said. I got the idea from you saying that. But and then she came back out. I swear to God, it wasn't. That wasn't me this time.
So her original answer is no, but that is a really great idea.
And both, her lying is as plausible as me giving her the idea. Yeah. So. We should have a fucking lie detector.
You can get them.
I know we can get them, but I'm fucking retired. I can't keep blowing money like this. The fucking cow of my audience is no longer.
Once you sell that Last Supper couch, you'll be able to. Maybe you can barter it out for a lie detector.
No, he gave me the Last Supper couch.
Yeah, well.
I know. And you can barter it for a lie detector.
He's got to make money. He's got to make money.
Interesting trades accepted.
You should do that.
No cash. This will only be a trade. Yeah.
Trade only. Yeah. Last Supper couch for ? Craigslist.
Can you do? This has to be on eBay. More people will see eBay because Craigslist will be local.
Shipping a 600-pound couch.
My brother does it all the time. They're just dead bodies.
It's first of all, it's more fun locally because we can get someone on a podcast.
There's nothing locally that we don't already get at the thrift store.
No,
and half the stuff at the thrift store is stuff you put there.
You don't know who the people that come over here are. Not the people who live on Craigslist.
I hear what he's saying. Honda Trail 70. What he's saying.
Ooh, that
I'm
would be
saying
nice.
He's
you
saying a Honda Trail 7.
You get a mini bike
good story on the podcast.
A mini bike. I want a mini bike. I've been looking at them. They're like
Chaille wants
bucks.
To break his collarbone. He doesn't know how to do it. So
desperately,
he's trying to buy a mini
I
bike.
Desperately want to break my collarbone while saying,
you told me you was born with no collarbone.
I want to break my collarbone while saying, wee.
This is great. Totally worth it. Smash.
Oh, and now I need a couch to lay on.
Yeah. Damn it. The irony. It hurts more than the actual pain.
So now I have to sell the couch, barter only?
Yeah. Now you have to sell your mini bike. After you break your collarbone, you have to sell your mini bike back to get a couch. It's like the hole in my bucket.
You know how we had that whole deja vu with
Dear Liza.
We both had the Gogo Bordella versus Molotov jukebox conversation separately.
Isn't that weird?
Isn't that weird? Wouldn't it be weird if this were Brian Hennigan's epiphany?
Yeah,
is trading out the Last Supper couch.
Or you guys should do the podcast and just keep on talking after it's over. That's my epiphany.
That's the epiphany.
That's the epiphany. That's where the really good stuff comes in.
Maybe we start doing that as a 64 bracket. Hey, here's the first podcast versus the second. Which one's funnier?
Can we do voting on Facebook with WooBox? Yeah.
Oh, really? The same way you set up my iPod to work perfectly?
That was a bust. See, we're on the edge of the range of the wireless because everything's contained indoors.
Oh, that's right. You fixed the other house.
Yes.
The other house. We got to get
still,
more houses.
And still, you don't know your neighbors. You don't
my
go
John
shit.
Stossel thing aired. And I just only know from a few emails. I didn't know. I didn't promote it.
Were you on it? Did they say you were on it?
Just via satellite and like three sentences.
Like a picture of you in the corner and.
Well, no, it was, yeah.
Yeah.
I was talking into a camera from Tucson to New York.
Did you say shut your mouth?
No, I didn't. I didn't have time. Well, let's just kill this and fucking take notes properly. Sacks underpants. And that's not the only merch. I also have stolen Bibles from the Dutch Antilles. One of which is in three languages, so maybe those go up. We don't know.
All three of those languages? Utter bullshit, by the way.
turns out
it doesn't matter which language the Bible's in. Still bullshit.
I don't know. The Dutch ones seem to strike me.
So we could sell as four Bibles. Those are from the Dutch Antilles right there? All four
No, two of them are from Atlanta.
Like you said, four from the Dutch Antilles right there. They will be for sale on the website, dougstanhope.com/store.
How about just the one? Just wait, save that one till we're doing your auction thing.
I don't know if we can
use it. It's weird how a Dutch Bible is mostly about windmills. You know, in the regular Bible, there's not that much about windmills, but in the Dutch Bible, it's almost all.
When you see
they crucify Jesus on a windmill
with tulips at his
feet,
with tulips. Yep. They throw tulips at him, stab him with a tulip.
Jesus creates energy.
Finally,
not just hype, but he can power your house.
Close it somehow, in case I use this. Close it.
Why? It's a fucking hidden track. They'll know it's over by the We should all wander away and keep recording for another 20 minutes, and then nothing should happen. What's the close? We need a closing song for the hidden tracks. Play the Go-Go Bordello. No, I'd go with Stolen Dance.
Milky Chance.
Shouldn't talk about it. Shouldn't talk about it. I want you, we can bring it on the floor. I've never danced like this before. Shouldn't talk about it.
I want you by my side, so that I never feel alone again. They've always been so kind, but now they brought you away from me. I hope they didn't get your mind. Your heart is too strong anyway. We need to fetch back the time they have stolen from us. Now, won't you? We can bring it on the floor. Dancing on, do the boogie all night long.